familiar hymns. And we have our baritone here to lead us. So that's good. And the service is meant to be more subdued than usual. Somber, I guess, but scripturally strong. And that's why I've chosen to do this. I will be reading some excerpts from this book to go along with the passages, because I believe it's done in such a way that it's educational for all of us to read it. Then there's going to be a singing of one verse of the hymn, and then some time to just maybe a minute or two, I'll sit down and meditate on what had just been read, and then I'll get up and start the next section of what we're doing. So I praise God for each and every one of you. Reading from Isaiah 53, verse 4. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We are all like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his or her own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We're going to be singing 151, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. We'll sing all three verses, and I'd ask you to stand.
Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand. The shadow of the mighty rock within a weary land, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way, from the burning of the noontide heat and the burning of the
give us this day our daily bread,
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
And please be seated. In your bulletin, you have the responsive reading for today. Crucifixion of Jesus. Then Pilate handed Jesus over to them to be nailed to the cross. So they took charge of Jesus.
He went out and carried his own cross and came to the place of the skull. It is the skull. In Hebrew, it is the skull.
There they nailed him to the cross. They also nailed two other men to crosses, one on each side, with Jesus between them.
Pilate broke the pillars and added another cross. Jesus is the Nazareth, the King of the Jews, was what he wrote.
And after the soldiers had nailed Jesus to the cross, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier.
They also took the robe, which was made of one piece,
without any seams in
it. The soldiers said to each other, "Let us not tear it. Let us throw dice to see who will get it."
This happened to make the scripture come true. They divided their clothes among themselves, and gambled for their robe.
Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there. So he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son."
Then he said to his disciples, "Here is your mother." And from that time, his disciples took her to bed with his mom.
And Jesus knew that by now everything had been completed and in order. To make the scripture come true, he said, "I am thirsty." They soaked a sponge in the wine, put it on a branch of hyssop, and lifted it up to his lips.
Jesus took the wine and said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and cried.
Amen. Before we start, if there's any special prayer concerns that anyone would like to have us remember in our prayers, good time to bring that to our attention. Yes?
Prayers for Emma, that Emma will be able to control her blood pressure. She has had a stroke in her eye and lost her vision, and now her blood pressure is just surging every once in a while.
Quite odd, so they can't get them in control. So first for her, that she will be able to relax and get this down. Well, we certainly want to include him in our prayers, and Peg's brother's wife, Peg's brother Michael, they are very, very religious in their own way. They live in Arizona, and they're very faithful Christians. So we know that the Lord is surrounding them with love, and our prayers will be very helpful. Yeah, Matt.
And continued prayers for Jackie, who's, I think, is getting better, but still obviously not out of the woods by any means. And also praise for Cindy's birthday. He's 47 today.
Oh, that's right.
Today.
Today.
Right.
Okay. Wow. Where did the years go? Praise
47.
47, right. Patrick.
From Facebook, we have several here. Robin Norton. Jessica, family still recovering from COVID. And then mom with one, prayers for Shirley, who is on hospice with COVID. And Robin also says on Facebook, please keep me in your prayers that they get my blood pressure down.
Okay.
Yes, to clarify, this is who Mom was talking about was Shirley Gable, Doug's mom.
Oh.
Doug Gable.
We have her on the prayer chain.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Diane?
Continue prayers for my grandson, Savion James. He had two seizures on Monday, one in the morning, one in the evening.
Oh.
So they upped his medicine some more, so now he's taking 5 pills a day. So please pray for him.
Sure. Marguerite?
Yes, prayers for our Christian brothers and sisters, not only in this country, but around the world. And especially for those that have gone away, that they should find that they need to get back.
Okay. Any other? Yeah, Doris?
Continue prayer for Bill. He will be coming home a week from Monday.
Yay. Well, praise God for coming home. To keep praying for the healing that he needs.
Doris.
And Doris. Doris is strong and faithful and courageous, but we need to pray for her. I just wanted to share with you, and she's probably watching Denise Durkas, who I don't want to take a lot of time with my affiliation with her, but I've known her a long time and her husband as well. And when Joyce talked about going through the test last Sunday, she was watching and she was facing an MRI because she had an aneurysm in her head that was taken care of a couple of years ago. And she said it was such a strengthening and comforting and affirming to hear what Joyce had to say about prayer. And she's very faithful, this girl, and she loves prayer. So when we do make these concerns, and if we can also talk about healing in what we're asking, it gives people encouragement. But you need prayer in your life. That's all we could say with that. I'm going to pray for Suzanne and her mom and dad. We're going through difficult times, and for Suzanne as well. And for Faye, that she's going to be having surgery on April 14th. Pray for her. And also for any of the others that we're looking at, because Ed, I wish Ed could watch us. He'd be thrilled to watch us. Ed Visaki, who's in the Hamilton House right now. The slow healing ankle that he broke. Sorry for that. Okay. Let us pray. Gracious God, we're so thankful that we can pray and come to Thee. And, not only that we can shed our anxieties about things and get some inner coping skills and inspiration, but we know that You hear our prayers and many of our prayers are answered. We We know some may seem not to be answered, but we never know exactly what the conditions are of things we're praying for. But God is listening, and God is willing to help us in all ways. And each and every one of us has an answered prayer we could talk about. So we ask your blessings of healing, and for those facing surgeries or going through difficult times in need of healing. We ask your peace to be upon those who are caring for them, especially this COVID time and the people who are dealing with caring for loved ones who have this COVID. And also all of us to listen to what they're telling us to do so that we could get back to some sense of normality. But we thank you, gracious God, we thank you for this Good Friday service that brings our message to our hearts and understanding as we again review the day that Christ died. Bless us with this good understanding. Certainly, we need to walk with our heads held high because Christ died for us and now he lives for us, and we will have resurrection through him. We ask your grace, blessings, and healing for our prayers in Jesus' name, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, we're going to be singing the first verse of O Sacred Head, Now Worship.
O Sacred Head, now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded, with thorns thine only crown. O Sacred Head, what glory, what this still now was thine. Yet though despised and gory, I joy to call thee mine.
Okay. I'm doing this from a book of a library that I've had since in fact, Peg was the one who found it for me and bought me this when I first was ordained. And it's from called The Communicator's Commentary, written, edited by Lloyd J. Ogilvie, who was a Presbyterian minister, very, very good preacher and minister. So the readings in the book, so that I don't get lost turning pages and stuff, might be a little bit different than what you have printed. I'm not sure of which books were taken from, but this should be very, very close. So I'll be reading at this time from John 19, verses 17 through 24. And he, bearing his cross, went out to a place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side, and Jesus in the center. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews. And Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. And then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. And now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. And they said therefore among themselves, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Therefore, the soldiers did these things. The meditation that follows that passage goes this way. John uses remarkable restraint in giving us his account of Jesus' crucifixion. His language is lean. The facts are simply stated without embellishment. Words here can in no way add to the meaning of God's gracious and costly deed. Jesus, bearing his cross, went out as Isaac bore the wood for the burnt offering from Genesis 22, verse 6. We catch here again the initiative of the Lamb of God as he moves out to offer himself as the sacrifice for the sins of the world. He went to the place, this is his mone, that we may be made secure in him, of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. Our word Calvary is from the Latin Calvaria, which also means skull. The king is between two others that are being crucified with him. The cross is his only earthly throne. Every criminal was identified by a placard over his head on the cross listing the crimes for which he was being executed. How ironic that the procurator, a pagan, should proclaim the kingship of Jesus to the many Jews who passed. Jesus was a king so universal that it was announced in the three major languages. This is surely a sign that this grain of wheat, which was falling into the ground, would bear much fruit. And what Pilate had written, he refused to change in spite of the protest of the chief priests. In a strange way, Pilate had the last say. It was the custom that the soldiers involved in a crucifixion would get the garments of the one put to death. John is very specific in pointing out that each soldier involved got one of Jesus' four garments, and that lots were then cast for his seamless tunic. Even in his gambling, scripture is fulfilled. This tunic was a priestly garment worn next to the body, like that which Aaron had been instructed to wear when he went into the holy place to make sacrifice. The early Christians were quick to point out that there was rich symbolism in John's statement. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. This seemed to mean that Jesus' death will not destroy the unity of the people whom he had gathered together. We're going to sing the second verse of O Sacred Head, and can remain seated.
Oh my.
next reading is taken from John 19, chapter verses 25 through 27. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. The meditation that follows goes this way. And there were four unbelieving soldiers at the cross. So there were four believing women standing by with fear and sorrow. The mother of Jesus, whose name is never mentioned in this gospel. His mother's sister, who was undoubtedly Salome, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. And then Mary, the wife of Cleopas. And this could have been the Cleopas on the Emmaus Road, and Mary Magdalene. These friends did not leave in Jesus' hour of desolation. Surely strength and comfort were shared with Jesus in this act of faithful companionship. Most people do not wish to be alone in the moment of death. And Jesus now reaches out in his hour of death and cares for his mother as she cared for him in his boyhood years. How tenderly the word made flesh in family life is revealed here. When Jesus calls her woman, he is not using a cold formal word, but a warm term of respect. It is to John, the disciple, and his mother's nephew that he gives the responsibility for her care. This act may also be saying that God's chosen people must find their home with those who have come to believe through the ministry of Jesus. That the true destiny of Israel is to be found in the fellowship of the church. Before we sing the next verse, I think of this passage as something empathetically we can really feel the depths of Mary's loss as she watches this crucifixion. And the pain and sorrow that Jesus is going through, but also seeing his mother viewing this in this family. And to come up with an idea that maybe it's when these things happen that those people who are called to be church people are able to be part of family and to help them. And how much more could have come to our understanding in this COVID-19 experience, where most people were dying alone. And maybe, if they were lucky, there was a window that they could see their loved one. And maybe there was a phone that they could talk to them. And he was so concerned with his mother, who raised him so well. And he hands her over to John and says, "This is your mother. Mother, here's your son." It causes tears, doesn't it? What an empathetic experience that is. Okay. So we'll sing the next verse. The whole sacred bed.
What language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end? Oh, make me thine forever.
Next passage is reading from John 19, verses 28 through 30. All things are accomplished. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. The meditation follows. Here is the heart of the gospel. Jesus has completed all the work his Father has given him. He has left nothing undone. And every detail of his ministry has been fulfilled and is the fulfillment of Scripture, even his cry of thirst. Both the work and the word come from his Father. Jesus is a man of flesh, and in this hour of need, he voices the physical thirst of every man and person. And the soldiers show some spark of kindness by sharing some of their sour wine with him. But there's also a rich symbolism beyond the physical cry. Jesus had told Peter earlier in the garden that he must drink the cup which his Father has given him. Drink every drink of suffering to the bottom of the cup. And in this cry of weakness, as the psalmist had prophesied, Jesus had come to the lowest point of his descent, but also to the moment of his being lifted up. In both of the Psalms, which speak so eloquently and specifically of the anguish of Jesus' thirst, which is in Psalm 22, verse 15, and Psalm 69, there is also a joyful praise for the Lord as triumph, which comes in Psalm 22, verse 31, and Psalm 69, verses 30 and 34. Hyssop was used to lift the wine to Jesus' parched mouth, as hyssop was used by God's people to sprinkle the blood on the doors of their homes the night in which they were delivered from captivity. Jesus is the Lamb of God whose blood is shed and the one door by which we must enter. The Jewish Passover is fulfilled in the sacrifice of the true Paschal Lamb. Jesus' last word is, it's finished. It's a cry of victory, not defeat. He is really in charge. He willingly accepts death because it is the completion of God's plan. The work of the incarnate Word has been accomplished. This is the moment of his glory, not his enemies. The verbs are active. Bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Did Jesus give his spirit to those at the foot of the cross who now symbolize the new people of God? Question mark. Let us sing the first verse of What Wondrous Love Is This?
What wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul? What wondrous love is this, O my soul?
So
continuing our reading from John 19, verses 31 through 37. Therefore, because it was the preparation day, that the bodies should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that the Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. And then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who was crucified with him. When they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. And he who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you may believe. For these things were done that the scriptures should be fulfilled. Not one of his bones shall be broken. And again, scripture says, they shall look on him whom they pierced. Reading from this meditation. It was the Roman custom to leave the bodies of the crucified victims on the cross as a warning to others. But according to Jewish law, a dead body was not to remain overnight on the tree. But you shall surely bury him that day, so that you do not defile the land which the Lord your God has given you. This was particularly true the day before the Sabbath, and on this day of preparation before the Passover Sabbath, which was a high day. Here is an explanatory note for the Greeks again. The Jews are particularly eager that the legs of the men be broken and the bodies be removed. Pilate grants their request, and the soldiers break the legs of the other two who were crucified with him, who must have shown some signs of life. But when they came to Jesus, they did not break his legs because he was obviously dead. Yet a soldier pierced his side. Are we able to explain this? Was this done casually as soldier sport? Men who live with death can become brutal. Or was he thinking, well, the man is dead, but I will make doubly sure. And he cut him open. Whatever the motive, the thrust of the spear brought forth blood and water, which has become the symbol of God's mysterious dealings with us. Whether blood and water coming forth so shortly after death is a miracle or a natural occurrence, Jesus is really dead. And in the face of those who argue that the death of Jesus is an illusion, John is saying this man of flesh had died. The sacrifice is complete and now life is offered. Jesus' blood has been shed and now gushes forth a cleansing stream of forgiveness. Likewise, the water of the Spirit flows forth as a river of life. The Spirit will now come forth from the depths of Jesus, rivers of water, as he had earlier promised. The writer has used two Old Testament prophecies to illuminate this meaning of this event. On the first night of the Passover, the most perfect animal from the flock was to be chosen as the Paschal lamb. And not one of its bones was to be broken when it was sacrificed, and its blood was poured as a sign of grace on this night of death. Jesus now has become the perfect Paschal lamb, shedding his blood to save his people, and none of his bones have been broken. And as in life, so in death, At the cross, Jesus becomes the focal point of those non-believers, the vengeful chief priests, hardened soldiers, that curious crowd, but also for that handful of believing women and disciples. Some mourn as for the loss of a firstborn son. But in the midst of this grief, the spirit of grace and supplication is poured out on the house of David. And from Jesus' open side flows the blood of forgiveness and the water of the Spirit. And this one who stands by becomes a faithful witness to these happenings through the Spirit. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. The Spirit, through this writer, is testifying to the truth of all these events. As John the Baptist bore witness at the outset of this gospel to the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world, so now John, the beloved, bears witness to the completion of the sacrifice of Jesus that men and women may believe. And he does not make this confession alone, but with the whole company of believers, a testimony which is confirmed by the Lord. Join me and Matt by singing the second verse of What Wondrous Love.
To God and to the Lamb I will sing, I will sing. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. To God and to the Lamb who is the great I am. While millions join the theme, I will sing, I will sing. While millions join the theme, I will sing.
Now continue the reading from verse 38 through 42. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, was secretly, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came, and he brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. And then they took the body of Jesus and bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as the custom of the Jews to be buried. Now in this place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So there they laid Jesus because of the Jews' preparation day, for the tomb was nearby. Meditation that follows. Sometimes, what is not given in life is given in death. Here are two disciples who have been secret believers, closet disciples, emerge and publicly ask Pilate for the body of Jesus. Judged and inspired by the glory of the cross, they openly confess they are followers of Jesus. by a courageous act they may have done in death for Jesus what they had not done in life. And Pilate may have been eager to get rid of the body. This has been a troubling case for him. These are men of status and wealth, both of them members of the Sanhedrin. Joseph came originally from Arimathea, a Judean town 60 miles from Jerusalem, and Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews, had heard of the new birth in the visit with Jesus that night. And they may have been among those rulers who believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, did not confess him. But now, after a long time of silence and fear, they come forth to announce their allegiance. Every secret disciple, especially Hebrew believers who had not yet confessed Jesus openly, being intimidated by those who seemed more powerful, would be encouraged when reading this gospel by the stand that Joseph and Nicodemus had taken. Their gift to Jesus was a new tomb and a dignified one, but hasty burial was at hand. After all, they were much aware that at 6 o'clock, the high day of Passover began. The extremely generous mixture of myrrh and aloes wrapped in the clothes in which the body was buried underlined again Jesus' kinship. Jesus was buried as a king. And in the garden nearby, the proximity of Calvary to the garden of the resurrection seems to symbolize a small step we take from accepting the death of Jesus to entering his life. Just a thought on this. I guess most of us, I would think, have certain discrepancies and fears about the death and dying. And as we see through the death of Jesus and the resurrection, that it's a lot maybe quicker experience than we think or we could understand. But the way he worded this passage, the proximity of Calvary to the Garden of Resurrection, seems to symbolize the small step we take from accepting the death of Jesus to entering his life in the new life after this life. And it could be shown no other way than the crook on the cross standing up for Jesus and saying, "Lord, when you get in your kingdom, remember me." And he said, "Today, you will be in paradise with me." We're going to sing the final hymn. This is the third verse of "What Wondrous Love Is This."
And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on.
Loves us. And for all who accept thee, there's another life coming, a life that will be a blessing to all who pass through and cross the bar. And we're thankful that we can feel good about those who've gone before us, and that there will be a reunion. And there needs to be other people who are skeptics, who are atheists, who are unbelievers, who are mockers, that need to be at least faced through the church, through our witnessing, whether they be family members, friends, neighbors, people we work with. Not that we have to go lecture anybody, but we can show who we are. We ask that you continue to bless us with the spirit that moves us today to not leave here sorrowful, but to understand the power of agony that it takes sometimes to follow thee in our lives as well as the lives of Jesus. Bless us and heal us and uplift our spirits and help us to continue to reach out to those we love, especially those who seem to be far, far away, that they will come to their senses and experience your love and the wondrous love of Jesus. We ask it in Jesus' name, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
And we're going to sing all the verses of Were You There, and I'd ask you to stand for that. May the Lord bless you and go in peace. Amen. Thank you so much.